Hello, everyone. Are you back in your seats? I'd like to introduce Brett Anderson and Matt Osman.
Hello, Jude.
Hello, hello, hello.
Hello.
Very careful not to do a Joe Biden there and fall over. But
Brett, you've been in trouble already this evening. Should we say about this?
Oh, yeah, I got shushed earlier. I came in and to listen, and I was chatting to my friend, and I got shushed. So during the middle of sleeping pills, I'm like, okay.
Thrown out of his own playback.
There's always one.
There's always one who spoils it for everyone else.
Yeah.
Well, it's delightful to be here tonight. I heard the first half of the album almost, and it sounded amazing, I think. Did everybody agree? Oh, just the way it starts, and you're like, oh, I've got a face mask on, it's amazing. Face mask, eye mask. We've been outside eating vegan gummy bears, it's all got a bit crazy already. So let's first start talking about the writing of the album. Brett, let's go back to those journeys you used to do between West and East London to Bernard's little house in Leighton, and you looking through the windows of those dusty tube carriages, thinking about your songs.
Yeah, I used to spend my life pretty much on the Central Line, going between. I had a flat in Notting Hill, and Bernard used to live in Leighton, out in the east, and constantly on the Central Line, shuttling backwards and forwards, and writing. And that's kind of what we did for many years of our lives. And at first, the songs weren't very good. And then they slowly got better. That's kind of what happens, That's my story.
What's it like revisiting them as well? I was looking back earlier today when I interviewed you both in 2010 after your victorious comeback at the Teenage Cancer Trust gigs in the Royal Albert Hall. The Suede Best Of came out later that year, which you'd worked on, Brett. And you said listening back to them reminded you of, why you had to write those songs. Why did you have to write those songs at that time?
That's a huge question, isn't it? I didn't feel that there was a voice at the time that was talking about those things and in that tone. I didn't think that. I thought alternative music was. It seemed to be talking in what I now call rock speak, which is basically kind of like rock cliches. And I thought I didn't feel that there was a voice actually talking about real things and about real life, and that's why that was my kind of thing that I wanted to do. My life happened to be working class, tatty, London, London life kind of thing, and I wanted to reflect that. I didn't think anyone else was doing it, and I think later that kind of like that obsession with real life became Britpop, because it was a Britpop was a, ours was a sort of an observation of real life, whereas Britpop was a sort of celebration of the same sort of thing. But it had a different slant, I think. But I think that's the germ of it, was from my desire to write about the world I saw around me, rather than about some sort of kind of 1960s California world, which I felt most other indie musicians were writing about.
It was a funny time, wasn't it? Especially for London music. There was, it was kind of like shoegazing and stuff like that. And there was a very deliberate, I think, move away from kind of connection with your audience. It was all about a distance and being cool and having that kind of sheen over you. You know what I mean? And I think we were quite lucky in a way that we came along at that time, because it felt incredibly fresh. I mean, we weren't doing anything that hasn't been done before by the Sex Pistols or the Kinks or someone like that. But I think it came in a time when that was incredibly unfashionable.
Obviously, you having known each other, for such a long time then, and obviously much longer time now, did you have conversations about wanting to, change things or kind of do something different? Or was it more that you weren't, having weighty conversations around, cafe tables, and you were just playing and kind of expressing yourself that way?
I think we did. I remember having specific conversations with Justine, actually, about we had lots of conversations about why singers don't sing in their own accents. and why singers don't sing in their own words. I remember having lots of those conversations at her place about it. So these very specific kind of conversations about sort of what we kind of wanted to do and the kind of band we wanted to be. But at the time, we weren't kind of capable of achieving that. We were kind of just sort of dreamers, really. We were just sort of theoretical. It's three kids sort of sitting around strumming guitars badly. And we weren't really capable of realizing these ideas. But there was a germ of an idea for the kind of band that we were, that we weren't able to realize until later. And it just sort of happened to coincide with the right time and the right place, really.
It was as much about talking about the kind of records that we loved, you know, the kind of things like the Pet Shop Boys, which weren't particularly fashionable amongst what we were doing at the time, but had that kind of sense of singing about a specifically London life. And he's got that voice, which, you know, couldn't be from anywhere else, you know, that kind of thing. So we spent, you know, like most young bands, I think, we spent a lot of time playing the kind of records we wished we could make, and then failing to make them.
Was there a particular moment or a particular time you got together as a band when you realised you were starting to nail what you wanted to do? Was there a particular song you wrote or performed together for the first time?
Yeah, I mean, when we first started, I mean, there was a lot of very, very frustrating years. Well, not a lot, I suppose sort of two very frustrating years, weren't there?
It felt like more, 90, didn't it?
It felt like forever. It was about sort of 2.5 years. And number one, we weren't very good. We weren't very musical, actually. We were kind of like, you know, just a bunch of kind of chancers. And B, kind of like, we couldn't sort of emulate what the current style was. And the style at the time was sort of like indie dance, baggy, that kind of shoegazing world. It was like very, very early 90s, 1991. And we simply weren't proficient enough to be able to do that. So what we had to do was just become Suede and become really good at this one single thing. We had a unique selling point, which we didn't realise, and that was just being Suede sort of thing. And I quite like that. I can see it in some other bands. You know, I see it in bands like The National and even back to someone like The Velvet Underground or something. And you sense that neither of those bands could sort of suddenly do a sort of funk record. And us as well could never do a funk record. I'm so glad that we couldn't.
We could, but it would be a terrible funk record.
Should we try and do a funk record? That'd be really ill-advised. Yeah. So. No, but do you know what I mean? We sort of became us. And at first, the version of us was kind of, it was this crappy sort of half-realised version, but we went away and we were ignored by the music industry for, you know, they passed on us because they were looking for the new cool band and we weren't that. And we sort of went away and were allowed to sort of just get on with it, and we wrote all these songs like Pantomime Horse and Drowners and lots of the songs you hear on that album. And we went and were playing them to sort of two people in pubs, and it was very frustrating, but it was all part of that kind of crucible of kind of that journey that you have to go, that kind of like ordeal you have to go through to get anywhere with anything creative, I think. And I'm really glad that we did it that way.
It's interesting that time in the early 90s, you know, the kind of some of the biggest bands of the, you know, the indie world are bands that had long periods of failure or periods of success then failure. So when you came to the recording of the album, you know, just hearing, you know, just the sound of you come together, and you sound like a gang, absolutely roaring and ready to go, kind of throughout the record. Did you have a plan for the record to be saying something specific to the world about you as a group of men, a group of people?
I think it almost happened early. I mean, a good kind of 3/4 of the record is what we were playing live. So there was almost a kind of Darwinian thing, that the things that kind of moved an audience and moved people were the ones that made it to the record. I mean, that's one of the things that's fantastic about playing to kind of like 30, 40 people. You learn really quickly what works, you know, what goes off, what makes people move, what brings people actually near the stage, you know. That was all we were really trying to do at the early, try and get people out of the bar.
There's that thing that happens when you're a new band, you have this sort of big D-shaped space in front of you, and it's kind of terrifying.
Oh
isn't
my
it?
God, it's so depressing.
It's like everyone's kind of like clinging to the walls.
They don't want to be infected with your kind of
your
failure, do they?
It's so depressing. So yeah, anything to reduce the big D shape space. But did we have anything? I mean, there wasn't a kind of manifesto, but maybe there was a manifesto. I don't know. Maybe it was didn't have an actual kind of written down manifesto, but. I don't know, all these things like failure and sort of, hesitation and sort of things like that, I kind of wanted to write about, but in a kind of rock context, I suppose. I quite liked bands that, there was lots of bands in the sort of 80s that inverted sort of rock posturing. I always found that really exciting inversion, bands like... Yeah, bands like Pet Shop Boys and Smiths and lots of those bands, the C86 bands and stuff like that. And they kind of turned all that on its head, didn't they? They turned the rock posturing on its head and there was something cool about about being, all the postcard bands and stuff like that. There was something cool about kind of being a bit square, wasn't there? Mm-hmm. To quote Huey Lewis. but do you know what I mean? There was. And I quite like that, inverting all of those cliches, those sort of priapic cliches of those raucous priapic cliches, and inverting them and talking about sort of failure and impotence and rejection and all these sorts of things,
Can I embarrass you with a quote from 1993?
Please do.
Okay. I haven't got my reading glasses on. That's very rock and roll of me, isn't it? All my stuff comes from my demon. This is you speaking. It's not you, Matt. You're excused here. Who I get on very well with at the moment. I can't see me hanging out with him in 20 years' time, though. We should break up amicably with dignity and occasionally get back into bed together for old time's sake. It's 30 years now, so are you still getting back in bed with your demon for old time's sake?
Well, I guess it's up to everyone else to decide, really. but yeah, I think I lost him for a while. And then we kind of, we had a sort of, a reunion, but... I kind of know. I think we know how to get on with each other now. It's a kind of an interesting relationship. I know when to sort of bring him out of his box.
Demon Gimp.
No, but it's interesting. The last week I've been, obviously listening to the album, watching that amazing performance of the Brits, and it's just so bizarre seeing the suits in the audience and. It's the version of the D-shaped space in front of you,
yes.
Just on a grand scale.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that nerve, obviously, this is something you still interrogate in your music, naught to fiction. You sing about, that persona of Brett. You sing about, the kind of teeth that you kind of need to be in a band still and, playing with the same sort of energy as you did back then. Both of you, thinking of, the people you were then, back in 1993, what would you say to them about, what they were doing? Was there any advice you would give them? From your many years of learned experience.
I mean, the trouble is that we've just been talking about how it's your failures that make you. And it truly, truly is. So there's tons of advice I could give my younger self to be kind of more successful, definitely richer and kind of healthier. But at the same time...
Lottery numbers, for example.
Exactly. that would be first then.
Yeah.
But... I don't know. We fucked up many, many times. And the one thing that I think's really good is that we've learned from our mistakes. You know what I mean? And I'm not sure we'd be making a record like Auto Fiction now if we hadn't made some shit records. I don't think we'd have that kind of hunger for kind of revenge. Almost, to revenge on those records and what we did then. So it's really difficult, isn't it? It's kind of like, if you could live a perfect life, would you? I mean, I don't know what it would be. It's a strange question. So
it is a strange question because it's part of the sort of thing of, especially the microcosm of rock music kind of encapsulates the paradox of that question in a way because the rock music is all about the unraveling, and it's all about the way it goes wrong. That's what creates the drama, Otherwise, you're kind of some boring, dull band, sort of like trudging up the ladder in a slow and kind of mechanical way. and I never wanted to be one of those sorts of bands, and all the things that went wrong are all kind of part of the story, and luckily, you know, you look back on these things and I think, oh yeah, you know, we were young men, and like when Bernard left the band, all those sorts of things, you know, we were young, we could have communicated better and stuff like that, but we didn't because we were young men. And that's part of the drama of the, you know, it's part of the soap opera, you know.
With this album, are there any tracks that you are particularly drawn towards, you know, because of a memory of the way you wrote them or the way you recorded them? You know, tonight, just hearing Moving, actually, just it was just so intense in this space. Mm. You know, that was one that I thought of in a completely different way again. What were the ones for you that leap out?
I always come back to Pantomime Horse, actually. Pantomime Horse is one of those things. I think it was the first thing that Brett wrote that I didn't kind of understand. You know what I mean? But because, you know, I've been there through to the start of the band and everything we did and the things we talk about. But that was one of those songs that I heard as a fan, you know what I mean? And I have my own ideas about what it's about and all these kind of things. We played it last week, didn't we? And it just doesn't, it never feels like an old song to me. Mm. It's really strange. The stuff on that record, Light Moving, which I love, it's an old song. Mm. You know what I mean? And it's a young man's song. Mm. But that one, I don't know. It's walked alongside me for a long time now.
Yeah, there's lots of songs on the album that are very special to me. Next Life's really special. That was something that when me and Bernard wrote it, I felt as though we'd sort of we'd gone somewhere we'd never been before, and it was very exciting for a band that, you know, basically a kind of scruffy guitar rock band to write something that felt like this little kind of jewel, but that was in a completely different kind of world, you know, it's a piano thing. And it didn't feel overblown to me. It felt there was something really elegant about the timing and stuff. And So Young as well. So the ends of the record, really, So Young was always a really proud song for me to have written. And I felt as though, again, that was a step up from what we'd done before. It felt like it wasn't just sort of like kind of punky little kind of shouty choruses. There was something very elegant about it. And I love the instrumentation of it and you know, the piano parts and all these sorts of things. So, yeah, those two songs I really remember. I mean, I have such fond memories of making the album as well, that time, and whenever it was 1992. And when we were making the record, it was such an exciting time. And I'm sure it must be incredibly exciting for every band who's in the studio making an album for the first time. And it probably does feel that like this for everyone, but it genuinely did feel like a kind of, we were doing something unique and special that no one else was doing. And that was a really exciting thing to be part of, that vanguard. We were a kind of vanguard of one. There was no other bands doing what we were doing. It felt like we were explorers, pioneers out there, kind of like cutting our own path through the forest in a way. And that was an incredibly exciting feeling.
And obviously when it came out and it did so well, you know, going straight to number one and later in the year winning the Mercury Prize, it had all this critical and commercial acclaim. Kind of, did that feel like a victory, or did it feel slightly odd given how you were, you know, working against the grain?
No, I mean, it always felt... I think we've always loved, you look at people like kind of John Lydon and people like that, who are these very odd, spiky individuals who had massive, massive, you know, number one records. I think that there's a British thing that we quite accept the fact that, you know, your Mark Bolans and people like that become pop stars, these kind of odd characters. I think we felt like we deserved it. Mm. It's proper, looking back on it, was probably quite big-headed. But at the time, I mean, I thought it was a brilliant record, and I didn't like a lot of records that were out at the time. So it just, for me, it felt like, finally, you know what I mean? It's kind of the rest of the world feels about this band, what I do.
How about you, Brett?
Pretty eloquent there, mate. sorry, what was the question?
I think Matt just summed it up so beautifully, didn't he?
Yeah.
We've got a little bit of time for questions as well in the end, so I will wait for you to answer somebody else's question.
Yeah.
That's all right.
Okay. Well, I won't answer. I think, yeah, it's a good record. I think it's flawed though as well. I think there's lots of things that I'd do differently about it. Talking about that whole, pulling that thread from jumpers sort of thing. I'd like it to sound more gutsy. I wish we'd recorded it much more sort of a live record, actually, in lots of ways. That's the way I do it now. When we record stuff now, like Autofiction, it feels like that's the real spirit of Suede, and I'd like to kind of go back to those old records and record them like that, but it's too late.
Really?
We've got about 4.5 minutes for some questions.
Yeah.
If you have questions, not comments, and short questions with a question mark on the end, that'd be great. Somebody right at the back there, who I saw first.
Can I go?
Over here. Yes, right in the back, back row, yes. Long dark hair.
Can I go in a minute?
I was just wondering, those first two albums especially, were just kind of, you and Ed just seemed so intrinsically linked in those two albums. I'm just curious about where Suede stops and
Ed begins on those two albums.
He's a member of the band, really, for those things, you know what I mean? I mean, he was there right at the beginning. He was in the rehearsal rooms as we were kind of like finishing stuff up. And we had that thing that I think, you had a bigger musical knowledge than me, but I think we were quite a young band and we didn't know a lot of stuff kind of pre-1977. You know what I mean? There was lots of kind of recency bias. And he just had this incredible background in stuff that we knew nothing about, you know what I mean? I can remember, he was into like Tangerine Dream and all these things that I would never have thought a human being could listen to, Todd Rundgren and things like that. But he was
human
always...
Humans can't listen to that.
Yeah, exactly. But he was always bringing kind of a kind of grown-up texture to us, you know? It's like the piano on So Young. You know, it's not something that any of us could have played.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting question. I think in the early days, especially with the first two albums, when Bernard was in the band, Ed he sat back and he kind of recorded things for us. And obviously, he's a producer, and there's lots of elements that he introduced. It was actually not until Coming Up. I think his creative role in the band was actually much bigger in Coming Up. So I think he stepped in because Richard was at the time inexperienced, and I think Ed sort of had a slightly different, there was a sort of shift in the dynamics. But on the first album, his role was as a kind of conventional producer, I think. But having said that, there's lots of textures on the album, like you said, the kind of string sections in Sleeping Pills, the kind of pianos in So Young, the kind of roads in Breakdown, kind of things
but
we wouldn't have done
I
without
think
him.
Even more just the sense that he was one of us, and this record was going to be as important as it was to us. He was never, felt like, you come across producers sometimes who have no skin in the game. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm trying to rush everybody.
I've got the mic. Can I ask?
Oh, someone's got a mic. Yeah, yeah. Sorry. Where are you?
Alan, did you bring your mic from home?
Should I stand or sit down?
Oh.
I'll stand. Okay, thanks. And going back to the first lyrics on the album we just heard, which are very obscure.
Can we make it really quick? Sorry.
She can start to walk out any time. When did that? What was the process of those lyrics ending up on By the Sea years later?
I wasn't even really singing lyrics. I was just singing sort of phonics, really. I quite like the idea of starting one of the most talked about records for decades with words that the journalists couldn't actually make out what I was saying. That kind of intrigued me.
Damn you.
As an idea. So it's just some words as sounds. I often use words as sounds and make no apologies for that. It's music isn't just about meaning, it's about feel as well. And it's there's obviously, it's a spectrum, but often use words as sounds.
Thank you so much, great question. Do you have another microphone somewhere? The microphone's hanging around. One at the front here. Oh, there you are with the microphone. Sorry, I didn't see you.
Thank you very much. It's only a short question. It's great to hear. Is the word sound staging, like when sometimes, you know, a guitar's coming from over there and there's lyrics coming from over there or something? You don't get it that much on Suede records, so it's great to hear it tonight, like where, you know, they're coming from different areas and stuff.
Quick question.
How do you guys feel about it normally? Do you want to do it more? Do you want to do it less?
You know what? Generally, I can't be bothered with these things at all. I really like... it's true. Generally, I like records that sound good coming out of like a car stereo. You know what I mean? That's kind of my measure of it. But I went to hear it. Stephen Wilson, who did this mix, I went to hear it up at his house. And he's a huge fan, and he knew the record inside out, and he worked with Ed on it. And I found it a really weirdly transporting thing, because sitting there listening to it was like the day that we recorded it. Because when you record, you've got someone there, someone that, you know, you've got one headphone on, one off, and you're in a space and the music's getting made. And I found it kind of like weirdly moving to actually sit there. It took me back in a way that I really didn't think it would. And it's the closest thing I can imagine to actually being in the studio as something's being made.
And Brett, you get thrown out when you're listening to it, obviously.
Do I what?
You get thrown out when you're listening to
it. I get thrown out and shushed when I listen to it. I don't listen to music in a kind of, I don't know how to explain how I listen to music. I don't kind of like listen with sort of hi-fi, and you know, I don't. That's not the way I listen to music. I quite like listening to music on my phone, or on like you said, car stereo.
Yeah, actually. Yeah.
What I love about car, what about sitting in the car, is that you can feel the bass. You can actually feel the bass coming through your ass. You know? It's really good. The rattle of the car stereo. So I'm not like Mr. Hi-Fi at all. So I don't know.
What a wonderful way to end this Q&A with a huge endorsement. Could anybody here feel a bass, you know, through their ass just now? I definitely could.
Rattled your buttocks. You are welcome.
It's yeah, like a microphone smacking your gluteus maximus.
It's got wonderful. To work, and it's got to work as a good song. It has to work on a sort of shitty stereo.
Yeah, otherwise,
otherwise it doesn't work. If it only works on kind of like good hi-fi, then it's not working.
But thank you to Stephen.
Thank
for
you
the
all
mix.
For coming.
Yes, thank you.
It is Sorry. Fantastic.
Thank you so much, Brett and Matt. Thank you all for coming. Hope you had a wonderful time. Thanks very much.
And thank you, Jude.
Thank you, Jude.
Thank you. Thanks for asking me.